Good evening, good morning, good afternoon. Wherever you're zooming in from, welcome to the second lecture of the Archaeology Lecture Series, co-sponsored by the UCLA Stavros Niarchos Foundation Center for the Study of the Hellenic Culture and the Cotsen Institute of Archaeology. My name is John Papadopoulos, a professor in the Department of Classics and the Cotsen Institute of Archaeology at UCLA. And I'm pleased to be your host this evening, or afternoon, or early morning. Today, as you can see from my background, I'm in Yanina. One of the most, together with our speaker, so at the Q&A, you'll actually see both of us will be a two-headed monster. And Yanina is one of the most beautiful cities in Greece, and I dare say one of the most beautiful cities in Europe. This time, next week, I'll be in Athens, and I'll be with Dr. Marisa Marthari, who I've already seen on the screen today. She's actually joined us from wherever she is, and she'll be giving us a fabulous talk next week on the early Cycladic site of Skarkos on the island of Eos. And this is one of the most spectacular new prehistoric discoveries that you can find anywhere in Greece today. It is truly a great pleasure to introduce one of my oldest friends in Greece, Konstantinos Zachos. Together with his wife, Dr. Angelika Douzoukli, they're a formidable archaeological duo, two of the finest archaeologists that Greece has produced. Kostas received his BA from the University of Thessaloniki and was then accepted at Boston University, where he completed his MA and PhD in archaeology under Professor James Wiseman. During his graduate studies at BU, Kostas attended seminars at MIT, Harvard University, and the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston. And it was during this time that he actually met my wife, Professor Sarah Morris, who was at the time a PhD student at Harvard. So talk about 6 degrees of separation. As with many Greek migrants in America, Kostas, who was lovingly referred to as Constantine by Cornelius Vermeule, the then curator of ancient art at the MFA, supported himself by working at, you guessed it, Greek restaurants at night. Kostas is one of those rare archaeologists who covers various aspects of Greek archaeology, especially Aegean prehistory, but he's also a specialist on Roman archaeology. With PhD in hand, he entered the Greek Archaeological Service, worked in several ephorates of antiquities before being promoted to ephor of prehistoric and classical antiquities. He has conducted postgraduate research as a privat docent at the Institute for Ur- und Frühgeschichte at the University of Heidelberg, and he's excavated widely in Epirus, the Peloponnese, the Cyclades, and in Albania, having served as the director of the excavations at the Zas Cave on the island of Naxos, as well as co-directing excavations at Antigonia in Albania, and most recently, the excavations at Nikopolis. Dr. Zachos has published widely on Aegean prehistory, the archaeology of Epirus, and over the past few decades, he's really focused his scholarly attention on the site of Nikopolis, for which he received funding from the Stavros Niarchos Foundation. He served as president of the scientific committee for the promotion and enhancement of the sanctuary of Dodoni, or Dodona, in Epirus, and on the scientific committee for the promotion and enhancement of the archaeological site of Nikopolis. He also supervised numerous projects of preservation and enhancement for many other sites in Epirus. Together with his wife, Angelika, he established no fewer than 3 museums in Greece, which has to be, I think, a record. One on the island of Lefkas, another in Artha, the ancient Ambracia, and a third in Nikopolis. And he also supervised the renovation of the new display at the Archaeological Museum of Yanina, making it four museums in all. He's lectured widely throughout the world, including the J. Paul Getty Museum, and I'm glad to see so many of the Getty curators in the audience today, where he was a visiting scholar. He's also lectured at the Cotsen Institute of Archaeology at UCLA, the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York, the British Museum, the Louvre, as well as at Cambridge, Oxford universities, and the University of Cape Town. He gets around, this lad. He's also taught at the University of Yanina. In 2002, he was offered the position of associate professor at the University of Athens to teach prehistoric Greek archaeology, a position he graciously declined. The reason he turned down the position was that he preferred to devote his time to the study, protection, and enhancement of Nikopolis. Machomene archaeologia is the term that is used in Greek, and it translates as archaeology of the front line in terms of the protection of antiquities and the cultural heritage of Greece. It would be no exaggeration to say that he's transformed the extensive site of Nikopolis, or Victory City, into an exemplary archaeological park. And for his efforts there, he was awarded the Prize of Europa Nostra in 2009, the highest honor of the European Union for Cultural Heritage. In 2010, the Academy of Athens awarded him the honor for his work on the conservation, enhancement, and research of the monuments of Nikopolis, and especially the Victory Monument of the young Octavian, who at Actium on September the 2nd in 31 BC defeated the combined forces of Mark Antony and Queen Cleopatra of Egypt in one of the most momentous sea battles in world history. He's a member of the Athens Archaeological Society and a corresponding member of the Archaeological Institute of America. Please join me in welcoming my friend and colleague, Kostas Zachos.
Thank you, dear John, for your good words, although a kind, I think, of exaggeration. In any case, thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to begin by thanking Professor Sharon Gerstel and John Papadopoulos for inviting me, Deidre Brin, for all her logistical assistance, the UCLA Stavros Niarchos Foundation Center for the Study of Hellenic Culture, the Cotsen Institute of Archaeology for making this happen. Before I begin, I would like to salute also many friends and colleagues in the West, East Coast of America, in Mexico, in Europe, and in Greece. Today, I will present to you a unique find from Greece, the Trophy of Victory Monument of the Sea Battle of Actium, that marks a turning point in the history of the ancient world. The sculptural decoration of the monumental altar that existed in the complex, as we will see, marks a last glimpse of Hellenistic art, the beginning of early imperial art. The monument was built in commemoration of the great victory Octavian, known in history as Augustus, achieved against Mark Antony and Cleopatra. But let's start from the beginning. One moment, okay. On the second day of September in 31 BC, Octavian, the heir to the political legacy and name of Julius Caesar, defeated the joint naval forces of Antony and Cleopatra off the coast of northwestern Greece in Epiros. The escape of the defeated couple to Egypt and the surrender of their forces to Octavian gave to him a glorious victory, which was integrated a few months later with the capture of Egypt, terminating thus the Hellenistic era in this area and transforming the Mediterranean to a closed Roman lake, known henceforth as Mare Nostrum. The Battle of Actium has been considered as one of the critical turning points, not only for the history of the ancient world, but also for the future geopolitical formation of the Mediterranean and European world. After the fall of Alexandria, Octavian emerged as the sole and undisputed ruler of the Roman world. When he returned to Rome, he held a magnificent three-day triumph on August 29 BC. The Roman Senate rewarded him with a host of honors, titles, and privileges. In January 27 BC, he was accorded the title Augustus, which means venerable, with religious connotations. Augustus demonstrated especially strong interest in the region where the events of the sea battle occurred. The Roman biographer Suetonius records multiple and impressive memorials established in honor of the victory at Actium. I am quote in English the translation of the Suetonius text. And to exalt the fame of his Actian victory and to perpetuate its memory, he founded the city of Nikopolis near Actium and established there athletic games. He enlarged the ancient temple of Apollo and adorned the area where he had set up his camp with naval trophies consecrated to Neptune and Mars. Throughout his plans for the region, Augustus advanced a strong element of propaganda, promoting his victory wherever he could as an intervention of the gods and above all Apollo, as well as stressing his own piety and respect for the region's traditions. Following the tradition inaugurated by Alexander the Great, who created new cities after victorious battles, Augustus founded Nikopolis, the city of victory. The foundation of Nikopolis is part of the wider expansion plan of Romanitas by the creation of new cities or the re-establishment of older ones. This policy, which was implemented by Julius Caesar and other officials of the Republican period, took a large dimension in the times of Augustus. The foundation of Nikopolis by Augustus was aimed not only at commemorating his victory in the nearby sea battle, but was incorporated into the broader context of the rehabilitation of northwestern Greece, which, like other regions of mainland Greece, was experiencing a period of economic disruption due to the Roman civil wars of the first century BC. The first inhabitants who contributed to the cynicism of Nikopolis came from cities and villages in Epiros, Aetolia, Acarnania, and the island of Lefkas. Besides the Greeks, among the first settlers, there were also Romans who contributed to the economic development of the city. Due to the privileges and the extensive territory bestowed by the emperor, Nikopolis soon flourished and became for centuries the political, economic, and social center of northwestern Greece. The archaeological site of Nikopolis is located on a picturesque landscape on the peninsula of the modern city of Preveza, between the Ionian Sea, which provides an open route to the west, and the Ambracian Gulf, which offers access to the hinterland of Epiros. To the south, beyond the peninsula, was the promontory of Actium. The city wall, which dates the time of its founding, enclosed an area of 150 hectares, which, with an estimated circumference of 5,000 meters. Great gates on the walls led either to the city's harbors or north to the suburb, an area within a sacred grove. Augustus reorganized the local yearly athletic games held at the sanctuary of Actian Apollo on the peninsula of Actium, transferring their venue to the suburb of Nikopolis. A paved processional road led to this suburb from the new city. It began from the northwest gate of the wall, traversed the north necropolis with its impressive large and luxurious funerary monuments, and concluded at the sacred hill of Apollo on the west side of the Victory Monument. The suburb was embellished with all the necessary edifices for the celebration of the new Actian Games, which were established by the emperor and soon became popular throughout the empire. The ruins of the stadium, the gymnasium, the theater, and public baths are still visible. Within the walls, the city was organized on the basis of crossing Cardines and Decumani, the axis of the rectangular urban planning of the Romans. Private residences and facilities, baths, cisterns, etc., framed the monumental public buildings in the center of the city. All these monuments reveal the flourishing days the city once had, its cosmopolitan character, as well as its wealth and culture, is obvious through monuments like the Odeum, preserved to a considerable height, or two luxurious houses, the Domus of Manius Antoninus, the Domus of Ecdicos Georgios, with high quality mosaic floors on their rooms. Barbarian raids of the 3rd and 4th centuries led to the reduction of the city to 1/6 of its initial size and its relocation to the northwest section of the Roman city. It's very interesting to notice that the new city was fortified using the old Roman fortifications on the east and north, while on the south, the new wall was built along the main street, the Decumanus Maximus, and the east section of the wall, the west section of the wall, on another street of the Roman city. However, the city had not declined, but continued flourishing as the ruins of the luxurious Christian basilicas decorated with unique sculptures and mosaic floors confirm. Here, I will show to you some of the mosaics. Those are from the so-called Basilica A. They are famous mosaics. This is the Basilica B. Those are mosaics from the same basilica. What do we know about Nikopolis from the literary sources and about the 11th century? From then on, the ruins of the once glorious city become the subject of visits and descriptions of travelers from all over Europe. Since 1995, I had the privilege to lead an extensive program of research and conservation of the site with the aim to promote it as an organized archaeological park. The project entitled Promotion, Conservation, Exploitation of Roman and Early Christian Monuments of Nikopolis was based on a plan which determined not only short but also long-term goals of interventions. In 2009, our efforts and results were awarded the European Union Prize for Cultural Heritage, the Europa Nostra Award. The key monument of Nikopolis, from a political, symbolic, and artistic point of view, is the trophy or victory monument of the Battle of Actium, located north of the city, at the very point where, according to the ancient written sources, Augustus had pitched his tent before the battle. Although the monument was first located in 1913 by the first excavator of Nikopolis, Alexandros Philadelphaeus, it remained unexcavated for decades. In 1989, William Murray, professor at the University of South Florida, and the prominent Greek archaeologist Photios Petsas published the results of the surface survey they carried out on the monument. As part of the extensive archaeological works that were launched in the 90s at Nikopolis, the completion of the excavations at the monument, as well as works of conservation and enhancement, took place. Today, the site is open to the public. The monument was built on two terraces, and the entire complex formed a kind of an open-air sanctuary, a temenos. On the lower terrace, the facade preserves 35 carved anchor-shaped sockets, which originally held bronze rams from the captured battleships of Antony and Cleopatra. A ram comprised an underwater extension of the bow of the ship to form an armored beak. This would be driven into the hull of an enemy ship to puncture it or disabling it. Except of a few fragments, due to their valuable material, the rams decorated the monument at Nikopolis have not been survived. A long Latin inscription decorated the upper part of the facade. 32 inscribed blocks have been found allowing the restoration of the inscription. I'm presenting in translation the restoration of the inscription for you. Imperator Caesar, son of the divine Julius, following the victory in the war which he waged on behalf of the Republic in this region, when he was consul for the fifth time and commander-in-chief for the seventh time, after peace had been secured on land and sea, consecrated to Neptune and Mars, the camp from which he set forth to attack the enemy, now ornamented with naval spoils. The upper terrace was occupied by porticus triplex, a triple stoa, around a central courtyard. Only the foundations of the portico and the stalobate of its north wing are preserved, along with a small number of architectural members above the stalobate, including column drums, bases, capitals, terracotta revetments, and an abundance of terracotta roof tiles, bearing stamped inscriptions with the names of the owners of several workshops. The findings from the excavation reveal that the morphology of the roofing of the portico followed the Etruscan tradition, which runs throughout the architecture of the Italian peninsula during the Republican period. The complete absence of fragments of a stone entablature in combination with rich typology of terracotta revetments confirms that the portico triplex had a wooden entablature. The study of the terracotta revetments justify the following. The cyma or gutter of the long sides of the porticos consists of two types. First, water spout in the shape of dolphin's head framed on both sides by dolphins. Second, water spout in the shape of sea wolf's head is framed at both sides by the sea wolf suckling the twins Remus and Romulus. The allusions of the iconography to the Battle of Actium and to Augustus himself, the new Romulus, it is evident. Due to the different representation, however, the two types may be located in different wings of the portico. The cymas were crowned with antifixes decorated with gorgons. Here is an attempt to reconstruct the Etruscan roof of the portico of the Victory Monument. Along the perimeter of the peristyle, remains of a total 31 pots for planting trees, vines, and shrubs in Roman gardens were excavated. The presence of ole perforata, as they are called in Latin, has been demonstrated in domestic, sacred, and royal gardens, and they have been considered by specialists as a lens through which we can understand the design and goals of sacred and monumental gardens. The vessels found in the courtyard are conical, with a large drainage hole in the bottom. An organized irrigation system provided the garden with water, as is confirmed by the lead pipes found in different parts of the monument. Sacred gardens are frequently mentioned in textual sources, as well as depicted in art. Their identification in the archaeological record, however, is extremely limited. The design of gardens inside the peristyle courtyard of a portico triplex, such as the case of the sanctuary of Venus at Pompeii, already corresponded to the Republican era. By the time of Augustus, this design dominated in all of Italy and the Mediterranean. The sanctuary of Nikopolis belongs to this tradition concerning the layout of the garden. For educational reasons, when landscaping the site for the public, an attempt was made to represent the garden of Apollo in some way. The real walls of the porticos were decorated with polychrome frescoes, with surviving hundreds of fragments of gold plaster that came to light during the excavations. They bear painted decoration in vivid colors, red, purple, blue, black, yellow, green. Most of the fragments do not bear figural designs, but on some of them, floral or linear decoration is present. In addition to the gold plaster, stucco revetments in molded reliefs belonging to the decoration of the walls of the porticos have been unearthed. The reconstruction of the painted walls of the porticons constitutes a challenge, since the gold plasters represent a unique discovery of painted decoration of the time of Augustus in Greece. Within the courtyard formed by the porticos, the foundations of two rectangular structures were discovered. They must have served as pedestals for statues. Various marble fragments with moldings were collected from the area of the pedestals. It is likely that the bronze statues of Eftichos and Nikon, mentioned by Suetonius and by Plutarch in his Life of Antony, stood on one or both of these pedestals. A quote from Plutarch. Caesar, we're told, who had lifted his tent while it was yet dark and was going around to visit his ships, was met by a man driving a donkey. Caesar asked the man his name, and he, recognizing Caesar, replied, "My name is Lucky, Eftichos, and my donkey's name is Victor, Nikon." Therefore, when Caesar afterwards decorated the place with the rams from the ships, he set up bronze figures of a donkey and a man. Centuries later, the Byzantine chronicographer Zonaras repeated the same story and added that those two highly propagandistic statues were later carried off to Byzantium and set up in the Hippodrome. South of the statue or bases are the foundations of 22 meters long rectangular structure. On the basis of the characteristics of the structure and on its central position in the upper terrace, it is concluded that the foundations belong to a monumental altar of the Temenos. During the excavations, thousands of marble fragments of pedalic marble, the weight of which is estimated in tons, were collected in the layers above the foundations and its perimeter, but also at a considerable distance from the foundation. They include a variety of moldings and fragments of classicized and relief sculpture. In some cases, particularly on the south side of the foundations, the fragments were found in piles in such numbers, which suggests deliberate dismantlement rather than abandonment and natural decay. On some fragments, there were traces of burning and chisel marks of the scraping away the relief from the main body of the marble slabs. The fragments range in size from a couple of centimeters up to 40 or 50 centimeters in length. Although most fragments coming from the core of the slabs are undecorated, a considerable number of fragments preserved figured relief and molded decoration. The work of conservation, sorting, and documenting the thousands of marble fragments in order to be maintained together in larger sets and to restore as much as possible of the pictorial program of the decoration of the altar was painstaking and lasted more than a decade after the completion of the excavations. In the working group which undertook this endeavor were included archaeologists, conservators, architects, and painters. This meticulous work would not have been possible to complete without the generous financial support of the Stavros Niarchos Foundation, to whose board of directors I would like to express my warm thanks. Soon, the results of the research of the monument, written by a team of prominent international scholars a covering 3 volumes will be ready for publication. Although Apollos' name does not appear on the dedicatory inscription of the monument, where Mars and Neptune are mentioned, the hill itself on which the monument was erected was referred to by the geographer Strabo, who lived in the age of Augustus, as the holy hill of Apollo, Ieros Lophos to Apollonos. On the lower terrace, in front of the south retaining wall of the monument, the excavations brought to light the foundations of a stepped altar, which according to the stratigraphy is dated to the Hellenistic era. This is an indication that a sanctuary existed on the hill before the arrival here the army of Augustus and himself. The monumental altar on the upper terrace as the central edifice for the cult rituals in the complex must thus have been dedicated to Apollo, the patron god of Augustus. The altar constituted the dwelling place of Apollo, the Eidos, as is mentioned by the ancient historian Dio Cassius. Among the relief fragments were those of 2 marble monolithic semicircular altars, one complete and the other in a fragmented condition. They are decorated with archaistic reliefs. The complete altar preserves a composition of 10 gods and heroes of the Greek pantheon. 7 of the figures walk towards the right, 3 towards the left. Towards the right, thus the last 3 towards the left. The first group begins with the Apolline triad. Apollo holds the lyre and plectrum. His sister Artemis holds a bow in her left hand and the front legs of a deer in her right, while their mother Leto, wearing a crown, faces them, the mother of the 2 gods. Besides her comes Hermes, accompanied by 3 nymphs who hold hands and walk to the right. Their manieristic movement is like that of similar archaistic reliefs of the age of Augustus. At the head of the next group is Hebe, the goddess of youth and daughter of Zeus, who is crowned and wears a long imation. Next to her comes Hercules, who was married to her, walking to the left, but turning his head back towards the goddess. The goddess of Athena, holding a spear in her left hand, an Attic helmet in her right, completes the scene. Similar archaistic scenes with Hermes and the nymphs, the Apolline triad, or other individual gods are known from various parts of the Roman world, decorating altars, candelabra, marble decorative vases, puteals, and other monuments. Exactly the same archaic composition as that of Nikopolis is depicted in a puteal from Corinth known as Gifford's Puteal, today in the British Museum. It's a long story about the discovery and the loss of this famous object, and they rediscovered it about 15 years ago. But it's not the time to present details about that story. While individual forms from the same composition are found in various archaic reliefs. For example, Artemis, the famous volute crater of Sosibios, the Louvre, is a copy of Artemis from the procession of the gods on the altar of Nikopolis. The beauty of the crater, which the signature of the Athenian sculptor Sosibius is preserved, as is known, inspired the British romantic poet John Keats to write an ode on a Grecian urn. The favorable reception of the archaic style during the reign of Augustus has been interpreted by modern scholars that reflects not only an aesthetic fashion, by the element of pietas in the Augustan cultural agenda. The finds from Nikopolis, which were the products of a Neoattic workshop, constitute a wonderful example of the favorable reception of the archaic style during the first years of the reign of Augustus. The study of the thousand marble fragments in classicizing style showed that they derived from two superimposed friezes adorning the facade of the altar. According to their themes, the fragments are grouped into three sets. The first set is a frieze depicting spolia, meaning heaps of weapons, shields, helmets, spears, greaves, cuirasses, and parts of ships, spolia navalis. We are placing this frieze the lower part of the altar. The compositions with piles of weapons, a beloved theme of Roman victorious art, may ultimately be inspired by the relief composition on the propylon parapets of the sanctuary of Athena Nikephoros at Pergamon. This theme becomes very popular after Actium and continues later in the imperial period. The altar of the temple of the Emperor Domitian at Ephesus, for example, was decorated with a such frieze of spolia. The parts of ships, such as bows, steering oars, rostra, and stern ornaments, which are included on the lower frieze, constitute an allusion to the sea battle in which Augustus emerged victorious. They serve to promote the victory as the will of the gods. The second set contains rich floral decoration. The fragments show acanthus leaves, dendrils, and flowers, which are reminiscent of the rich floral decoration of the Arab Archaeology in Rome. After a long process of mending together 39 fragments, it turned out that the floral motifs comprise anthemia, decorating a relief pediment with acroteria in the corners, covering an entire marble plaque 3 meters long. This plaque, and as well a second one with the same decoration, belong to the crown of the sides of the altar. Here you can see some examples from Greek altars, the crowning on the sides of the altars. They are called kratevtei in ancient Greek. So it turned out that our floral decoration comes from the side decorating a pediment. The third set is a frieze depicting a Roman triumphal procession moving towards the left. The origin of the Roman triumph is lost in the haze of the history. The relatively few descriptions that survive allow us to conclude that through the passage of time, a formal order of the entire procession had evolved and become established. The fragmented finds at Nikopolis represent all known aspects of the fully involved Roman triumph. According to the ancient sources, Augustus was among the few honored with a three-day procession, the first celebrating his Dalmatian victories, the second the naval victory at Actium, and the final day, the conquest of Egypt. I will devote my attention to aspects of the frieze that prove this decorative composition specifically depicts the second day of the triumphal celebration, namely the naval victory at Actium. The only slab of the 22 meters long frieze, preserved in its entirety by some stroke of good fortune, depicts the culmination of the triumph, namely the triumphator writing the quatrica. The total length of the slab reaches almost 3 meters, and its height is almost 1 meter. The Augustan chariot is the focal point of the slab. It is led by four vibrant horses moving forward at a slow trot while a slave holds the reins. The charioteer is Augustus himself, crowned with a laurel wreath, wearing the toga picta, the elaborate garment worn by generals in triumphs. The characteristic features of Octavian's profile give him an imposing and austere dignity. The chariot is lavishly decorated with acanthus leaf vines between columns crowned with Corinthian capitals. It's very low relief. Maybe you cannot see the decoration of the chariot. Two children stand in front of Augustus, one female and one male, with only the upper parts of their bodies visible. Elsewhere, I have proposed that they may represent the twins of Antony and Cleopatra, namely Cleopatra Selene and Alexandros Ilios. This, however, is not the time or place to discuss this topic in detail. Augustus's chariot was led by non-Roman figures on foot or on horse, who must represent foreign dignitaries of note. Their location in front of the chariot and the laurel wreaths on their heads distinguishes them as very important individuals, most likely leaders, Reges Socii, who came to the aid of Augustus in the most opportune moment. Their exotic dress both defined their ethnicity and added to the pomp of the procession. Nine male togati wearing the distinguishing toga exigua rather than the typical Augustan toga and crowned with laurel wreaths follow the chariot. The men that follow must be the senators who participated in the Actian victory, together with other magistrates of the city of Rome. Among the countless fragments depicting other aspects of the triumph, like musicians, here you can see musicians, he's a musician. It was, this fragment got together out of 22 mended pieces. You can imagine how long took the process of mending all those fragments. Slaves, here is a bearded slave, sacrificial oxen, and trophies of war. We will turn to those fragments that refer specifically to the naval battle of Actium. Several joint fragments depict ships carried on wooden wheels. Here you can see the ships, the aflastra, wooden wheels. On the deck of the ships recline bearded figures, most probably representing prominent barbarian officers and allies of Antony. It was customary, according to the literary evidence, to feature entire ships in triumphs celebrating naval battles. The evidence from our reliefs is in accordance with the poetic description of the Actian triumph by the Roman poet Propertius in one of his elegies, which represents the only surviving description from the time of Augustus. In it, he sings of, and I quote, the Actian prows racing down the Sacra Via. Just these two sections clearly depict aspects of the second day of the three-day triumph of Octavian Augustus, which celebrated Actium. The iconography of the Roman triumphs inspired artists through time during the Renaissance, a period of fascinated by the ruins of ancient Rome. Andrea Madegna created a masterpiece, the nine canvas epic, The Triumphs of Caesar, commissioned by the Gonzaga family of Mantua at the end of the 15th century. The paintings were acquired by King Charles I in 1629 and brought to Hampton Court Palace in England, where they are even today on show. The sculptural depiction of Augustus' triumphal procession turned up to us due to hard work, as well as a touch of fortune. Long archaeological field work has brought to light all those fragments. However, the critical turn was the discovery of the slab with Augustus himself, the center of gravity of the whole composition. That find dispelled the few clouds of doubt regarding the identification of the scene. The relief composition of the upper frieze of the monumental altar on the sanctuary raised by Augustus to commemorate his victory, crafted in pedelic marble by Greek craftsmen, belongs to the so-called Roman historical reliefs or state reliefs, which adorned a range of Roman public monuments and constituted the most distinctive form of Roman sculpture. Unlike the Greeks, who drew on mythology to portray important monuments in their civic life, like Amazons, centaurs, giants, the Romans prized faithful, realistic, iconographic rendering of historical fact. The earliest historical relief on Greek soil is the monument of the Roman general Aemilius Paulus Adelphi, a long frieze with scenes from the Battle of Pydna, 168 BC, runs around the upper section of a tall rectangular base, on top of which was an equestrian statue of Aemilius. The monument was carved by Greek craftsmen and was originally intended for Perseus, the defeated king of Macedon. As it has been pointed out by prominent scholar, when one surveys late Republican and Augustan reliefs, one does not detect a gradual, step-by-step development towards the large processional friezes of the Arapakis Augusti. Instead, they seem to spring into existence quasi fully matured, like Pallas Athena from the head of Zeus. The Nikopolis reliefs, accomplished 20 years before the consecration of the Arapakis in Rome, constitute the missing link to the chain of the development of Roman art. They belong in the immediate aftermath of the Battle of Actium in 31 BC and are still in a strong and vigorous late Hellenistic style before the formation of official Augustan art as we know it later. Indeed, the sculptures from Nikopolis form some kind of a bridge which connects the forthcoming Augustan art with the glowing past of Hellenic and Hellenistic art. Their mark is still vivid on this specific work, like the pose of the figures or the vivid naturalistic plasticity of the horses, which in turn reveals a familiarity of the artists with the great sculpture works on the Parthenon. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to thank you for your attention.